Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present The Far Cry by Fredric Brown. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. Chapter 1. Sudden terror in her eyes, Jenny backed away from the knife, her hand groping behind her for the knob of the kitchen door. She was too frightened to scream, and anyway, there was no one to hear. No one but the man who came toward her with the knife. And he was mad. He must be mad. Her hand found the knob and turned it. The door swung outward into the night, and she whirled through it, running. Death ran after her. 8 years passed. Then, what happened started quite casually, as most things do. It started on the 18th of May, a Thursday. There was a man named George Weaver, who had just taken a room at La Fonda, a hotel in Taos, New Mexico. He had just finished shaving. He was wiping the residue of lather from his face with the moistened end of a towel when the phone rang. He hung the towel over the edge of the washbowl and went out to the hotel room to answer the phone. "Hello," he said. "George Weaver." The voice was familiar, but he couldn't place it. He said, "Yes, this is Weaver. This is Luke, George. Luke Ashley." Weaver's face lighted up. "The hell it is. What are you doing in Taos? How'd you know I was here? Where are you?" The telephone chuckled. "Which question do I answer first?" "Where are you?" "At the hotel desk downstairs." "Then the other questions can wait. Come on up, Luke." Weaver cradled the phone, then opened the door of his room and left it ajar while he went back to the bathroom and finished drying his face. A chance to see Luke Ashley was both pleasant and unexpected. He hadn't seen Luke in, it must be over 2 years now. Looking at his face in the bathroom mirror, Weaver wondered how much change Luke would see in it. The last few months had been pretty hard on that face. They'd done things to it, and it hadn't been much of a face to begin with. Always a little thin, it looked gaunt now, and the eyes had a haunted look. He heard Ashley come in and met him halfway across the room. "Luke, old boy, how in hell did you know I was here? I didn't know I was stopping over here myself until I checked in an hour ago. Intended to drive on through to Santa Fe." Ashley was tall, thin, balding. He looked a bit like William Gillette as Sherlock Holmes. A very appropriate resemblance, Weaver had often thought, for a writer of true crime stories for the Fact Detective magazines. And Ashley sometimes humorously capitalized on it. As now, he said, "Elementary, my dear Weaver. I saw your car parked outside. A green Chevy coupe with a Missouri license." Ashley sprawled himself into an easy chair and threw his long legs over the arm of it. "Put on a shirt, George, and we'll go down and have a drink somewhere."
"But how did you... That car's only a year old, Luke, and you never saw it. How'd you know what kind of car I had?"
Ashley sighed. "All right. If we must get down to mundane facts, I'm on my way to the coast, L.A., and I routed myself through Kansas City so I could stop over a few hours to see you. You'd left only a day ahead of me, and Vi told me you were heading for Santa Fe and what route you planned to take. She described your car and gave me the license number in case I caught up with you, so I've been watching for it. When I got to Taos just now, I drove once around the plaza, and there you were, parked in front of the hotel here. So I came in and asked the clerk if they had any George Weavers on hand, and they did." Weaver nodded. "You must really have been highballing to catch up to me when I had a full day's start." "Well, not too much, maybe. I've been taking my time driving, watching the scenery and not pushing too many hours a day. I've got orders not to be in a hurry about anything. I suppose Vi told you about that?" "A little. I didn't talk to her very long. What are your plans, George?" Weaver had taken a sport shirt from the suitcase open on the bed and had put it on. Now buttoning it, he walked over to the window and stood looking out. He said, "Look at those goddamn beautiful mountains. I could look at them all summer, and maybe I will. I was heading for Santa Fe. But now I don't know if I'll go the last 70 miles or not. Hell, it's 5 years now since I lived there, and I don't know whether I want to see the people I used to know then or not. Haven't kept up correspondence with any of them. Vi keeps up correspondence with Madge Burke there."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.